The next stage is generativity versus stagnation. And in our majority culture, and that's the Caucasian culture, it's approximately between our 40s and our 50s. Subcultures in our majority culture may follow the same thing. They may have different ones. So I'm just acknowledging that there are different life paths for people who belong to different cultures in our country. Generativity versus stagnation is all about the world of work. And it's not necessarily paid work, but what do you work at? And again, it's in the context of a relationship. For example, somebody who's a full-time mother is working on raising her children. She has physically, with a man, generated these products that are valued by society. Right now we're probably overpopulated, so you should make fewer products, but you should still make products, make these children, or adopt them so that you can turn them into productive citizens for that community. Okay? So the work of being a mother, of being a father, of being a parent, is generative. You are investing in the future, okay? And I think that's the most obvious example. But what Erickson does mean by generativity, in the general sense of all work, is this investment in the future. If you are in the medical field, providing health care invests in the future, okay? Reducing diseases, making people healthy so they can go on to be productive members of society. Teaching is generative. Teaching people the skills they're going to need in their future lives. Being a sanitation worker, collecting all the garbage so there is room for the future generation, is a generative job. So our work, be it paid or unpaid, is being generative. And we need to do that in order to grow, in order to enhance, practice our ego skills. Okay? The opposite of that is stagnation. The person who's not providing for the next generation, the person who is isolated, and so you can see that previous stage influencing this current one. The person who is isolated, the person who mistrusts, the person who has a sense of doubt and shame about what they do, who's guilty about any kind of plan for their behavior, is not going to produce, is not going to generate something for the future. One example would be a person who has a midlife crisis. You know, they maybe were on shaky ground before this in the resolution, but on the surface of things were looking good. And then they go off, they divorce their spouse, they get a fancy car that's too young for them, they get a mate that's too young for them and not really interested in them, they have sex, but there's no real deep self-disclosure. They're all about themselves. They've abandoned their children. Their work is only for self-aggrandizement. You know, if it makes them look better, they're going to do that. It doesn't matter if it furthers the company or furthers the community. This is a person who's stagnating. They're not producing anything of value. They're not exercising ego functions in the way that psychologists mean ego functions. However, as before, you want to be generative, but you do want to have enough of a self-focus that you're going to take care of yourself to be generative. You know, we run across parents who are completely exhausted, incapable of doing adequate work, if they are indeed, have paid employment as well as the job of a parent, because they so over-invested in these kids that they're not taking care of themselves. They're not stagnant enough. They're not remaining still enough to have some self-care. And that's not good. So yes, lots of generativity, but enough self-interest, enough stagnating, enough standing still to take care of yourself and be more generative. So again, you see that positive resolution, but with enough of the negative side to make it even better. Okay? An artistic analogy for those of you who are artistic out there. White looks whiter when it's next to black. So you need the black to define the white. Black looks blacker next to white. You need the white to define the black. Yin and yang, for those of you who looked more into Carl Jung's theory, this idea of opposites. So again, we have this in Erickson's theory. Now we're on to the last stage, and that is integrity versus despair. And Erickson's ages are probably going to be the most off here, because back when he was alive, people didn't live that long. And people worked less. They retired earlier than they do now. We don't have a mandatory retirement age in the country anymore, and so people are generating, becoming grandparents, great-grandparents, living longer, and so generativity probably lasts longer than what was in your handout there. But let's look at integrity versus despair. And it's important for you to look at it now, because when you actually physically get to that stage, it's going to go better for you. Remember at the beginning of my talk, I mentioned how life, your life, is a work of art, and that you need to put into it what you're going to then feel good about when you look back on it. And if you spend any time with older people, your grandparents, and maybe for some of you it's going to need to be great-grandparents because you're sort of young, and you need people who are really up there in their 70s, 80s, and 90s, they do spend a lot of time reflecting on their lives. When you get together with them, they're often telling stories of their youth and so forth, because they're reflecting on that. And so a life review is quite common for people at the end stages of their life. When they look back on their lives, do they look back on it and say, you know, I did an okay job. I did the best I could with what I had at the time. Oh yeah, I made a mistake. I wasn't a very good parent to my son. But you know what? I was 17 when I had him. What kind of skills, what kind of resources did I have at the time to do that? If I look and see, did I try? Did I do the best I could, given what I had at that time? It's going to have to be good enough. And so when I look at my entire work of art, is it pretty enough? And if people say, yes, I did what I could, then they have a sense of integrity. They live the remainder of their lives well. They're having fun. They're satisfied with the situations, their relationships with peers and with subordinates, because now all that's left are children and grandchildren, many people younger than them, are also satisfied. They're able to pass on wisdom, which is generative. It's also industrious. They take the initiative to talk to people much younger than themselves. They do that on their own, so they're autonomous, and they trust that people will accept that information. So you see in this last stage elements of all the previous seven. You want the person to have a sense of integrity. When people do, they die well. And I know that sounds like a weird thing to say, but you're gonna die. You can die badly, which is what happens when people fall into a sense of despair, and I'll get to that in a second. But dying well means not being afraid of it, is saying, that is a part of my life. That finishes the picture for it. It puts the frame around the picture, because the picture's done. And so there is no fear. And people often say, well, if you're not afraid of death, then don't you kind of welcome it and it makes it happen sooner? No. In fact, if anything, there's probably no correlation at all, but if there was, it would be the opposite. If you're not afraid of death, you're not going to experience that anxiety that can induce all kinds of physical symptoms that may then trigger something that's going to kill you. So dying well doesn't mean dying early. It just means not fearing it, seeing it as the final chapter. It does happen. It happens to everyone. There are people who deny death, and that's just not healthy. Now let us look at the despair. A person at this age may have gone through the previous stages badly. They're isolated. They're stagnant. They don't trust. They have guilt. They have doubt. They have shame. And so when they look back on their life, they say, it's ugly. I have so many regrets. I was an awful father. I don't know how to make up for that. And that's sometimes what people who are despairing do. They try to change those things. They call up their 50-year-old son and they say, hey, let's go to the basketball game together. And the son, who never had his father come to any of his games, is saying, Dad, I'm busy. I'm, you know, raising my own children. I don't have time to go back and be the son so that you can be the father you wish you were. So people who have the sense of despair are trying to relive the life. It's like trying to paint over the canvas. And you can't. You know, the paint is dry. It's going to leak through, and anything you paint on top of it is just a mucky mess. And so the people who have the despair are fearful. They are full of regrets. The relationships they have with others are tainted by those regrets because they are acting in ways that are not appropriate to that current relationship. And they don't die well. Maybe if there is any correlation, I don't know, they might die earlier. They're so frightened and fearful and wasting the time they have to live well by trying to make up for those past mistakes. And so